Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Loot Britain and the Benin Bronzes by Barnaby Phillips, narrated by Michael Page. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Clarifications. 1. The historic West African Kingdom of Benin is located in modern-day Nigeria, a former British colony. Benin City was and is at the heart of this kingdom. In 1975, Dahomey, a former French colony to the west of Nigeria, changed its name to Benin, in part because its coast lies on the Bight of Benin, and also because its government wanted a name that was ethnically neutral but evocative of past African glories. The territories of this Republic of Benin were only on the periphery of the historic Kingdom of Benin, and this country has no connection to the Benin Bronzes. Any references in this book to Benin are to the kingdom that is now in Nigeria, and not to the Francophone country next door, unless specifically mentioned as the Republic of Benin. 2. The cast metal sculptures of the Kingdom of Benin are referred to collectively as the Benin Bronzes, although most are made of brass and only a small proportion are bronze. The term Benin Bronze is often used to include all the kingdom's treasures, including ivory carvings, such as the wonderful mask on the cover of this book. Timeline. Circa 900 to 1170, Ogiso dynasty rules Benin. Circa 1200, beginning of Oba dynasty, Aweka I. Circa 1280, Oba Ogwola. One tradition says bronze and brass casting in Benin begins during his reign. Circa 1440, Eware the Great expands Benin's empire and builds inner city walls and moat. 1486, first recorded European contact. Portuguese sailor João Afonso de Aveiro arrives in Benin City and is received by Oba Ozolua, the conqueror. Circa 1504, Oba Isigi ascends throne. Benin is in a golden age of cultural and military power. 1515, first Portuguese priests arrive in Benin. 12 August 1553, an English fleet under Thomas Wyndham sails from Portsmouth for Benin. 1593, Dutch ships arrive off Guinea coast. 1719, Capuchin mission returns to Europe, marking unsuccessful end of pre-colonial attempts to convert the Edo to Christianity. 1807, Britain abolishes slave trade in its empire. 1837, Royal Navy seizes last Portuguese slaving ship in Benin River. 1861, Lagos annexed as a British colony. 1884, Britain establishes Oil Rivers Protectorate. 1884 to 1885, Berlin Conference. European powers agree the Niger districts fall within Britain's sphere of influence. March 1892, Vice Consul Henry Galway visits Benin. Oba Ovonramwen signs Treaty of British Protection. 1893, Oil Rivers Protectorate becomes Niger Coast Protectorate. British presence expands. February 1896, Ralph Moore appointed Consul General of Niger Coast Protectorate. 3 January 1897, Deputy Consul General James Phillips and party arrive at Ugoton en route to Benin City and ignore Ovonramwen's pleas to delay their visit. 4 January 1897, Phillips's expedition massacred at Obina. 9 February 1897, British punitive expedition under command of Admiral Harry Rawson disembarks from Royal Navy ships and begins journey into Niger Delta. 18 February 1897, Rawson takes Benin City. Ovonramwen flees. British find and loot the Benin Bronzes. 21 February 1897, fire sweeps through Benin City. May 1897, first auction of Benin Bronzes in London. June 1897, celebrations of Queen Victoria's Diamond Jubilee. 5 August 1897, Ovonramwen surrenders. 15 September 1897, Ovonramwen sent into exile in Calabar. September 1897 to January 1898, first exhibition of Benin bronzes in British Museum. 28 June 1899, Chief Ologbosere executed by British after a brief trial, marking end of organized Edo resistance. 1900, British create Protectorate of Southern Nigeria. 13 September 1909, Sir Ralph Moore commits suicide in London, after which his widow hurriedly sells his two Queen Idia masks to a dealer in Chinese art. 1 January 1914, Protectorates of Southern and Northern Nigeria merged to form Nigeria. 14 January 1914, Ovonramwen dies in Calabar. July 1914, Ovonramwen's son, Egwobasimwin, installed as Oba Eweka II, marking end of interregnum and restoration of Oba dynasty. February 1933, Eweka II dies, and in April his son installed as Oba Akinzwa II. 1933, Chief Jacob Egarevba publishes Ekere Vitan Edo in Edo. In 1936, it comes out in English as Short History of Benin. December 1953, Benin bronze head sold at Sotheby's in London for £5,500. March 1957, Nigeria's National Museum opens in Lagos. 1 October 1960, Nigerian independence. December 1968, Benin bronze head sold at Christie's in London for £21,000. 22 April 1972, Kenneth Murray, founder of Nigeria's museums, killed in car crash en route to Benin City. July 1974, Ingersoll Flute Man, a.k.a. Toochly Poochly, sold at Sotheby's in London for £185,000. January to February 1977, Nigeria hosts Festac, Black and African Festival of Arts and Culture. British Museum refuses to lend its Queen Idia ivory mask. 1978, Akinzwa II succeeded by Oba Erejiwa. July 1989, Benin bronze head sold at Christie's in London for £1,320,000. 1997, Benin City commemorates centenary of British invasion. 2007, formation of Benin Dialogue Group, bringing together the Oba, Nigerian government, and key European museums, including British Museum. May 2007, Benin bronze head sold at Sotheby's in New York for $4,744,000. 20 June 2014, Mark Walker returns two Benin bronzes to Oba Erejiwa. 2016, Benin bronze Oli head sold for £10 million. October 2016, Erejiwa succeeded by Oba Eware II. March 2017, Prince Gregory Akinzwa, uncle of the Oba, informs Benin Dialogue Group of plan to establish a Benin Royal Museum. 28 November 2017, President Emmanuel Macron of France in Burkina Faso says European museums cannot hold on to Africa's cultural heritage. November 2018, SARS Savoy report, commissioned by President Macron, says France should return objects taken by force or presumed to be acquired through inequitable conditions. July 2019, Edo State Governor Godwin Obaseki announces agreement with architect Sir David Adjaye to build Benin Royal Museum. August 2020, British Museum reopens after COVID-19 lockdown. New information panels by Benin Bronzes are entitled Benin, Colonial Conquest and Military Looting. Preface, Relatives Behind Bars. Walk across the British Museum's Great Court, through throngs of people and a babel of languages, down a stone staircase, and you will come to the darker and quieter gallery where Africa's treasures are kept. At one end of the gallery, a display of 56 brass plaques seems to float in front of a wall. The plaques are held in place by slim poles that run vertically behind. The intention is to suggest how they once decorated the pillars of a West African palace. They are cast in bas-relief, meaning they are three-dimensional, and on a relatively small space, about the size of an A3 sheet of paper, each one captures an abundance of exquisite detail. Kings and courtiers, early European explorers, hunters and musicians, leopards and fish, rosettes and swords. The figures face outwards on ceremonial display, their large heads slightly disproportionate to their bodies. The plaques are some 500 years old and depict the stories and beliefs of a civilization that traces its origins at least another 500 years further back in time. They come from Benin in modern-day Nigeria. They were looted from the palace of the King of Benin, the Oba, in 1897 by British soldiers and sailors, who also took thousands of other objects, including statues, commemorative heads, and ivory carvings. On a spring day in 2017, a prince from Benin and a curator sat on a wooden bench side by side, looking up at the plaques. For a long time, they sat in silence. Neither is an openly demonstrative person, but both knew this was a significant moment. Julie Hudson has spent more than 20 years in the African galleries of the British Museum and is well versed in the controversies around the collection she curates. Prince Gregory Akenzwa, who was a few months from his 80th birthday, is the great-grandson of the Oba who was overthrown by the British in 1897. He has been tasked by the current Oba, his nephew, with ensuring the return of at least some of the kingdom's treasures. They gazed at the display. The British Museum's subtle lighting of the plaques, warm and angled, highlights the relief and shade on each one. The word brass may evoke a shiny, even tacky quality, but some of these plaques are gunmetal grey, and others, encrusted in fine red dust, have more of the rich hue of copper. Art historians and archaeologists debate if this coating of dust was a deliberate aesthetic effect or is simply a result of the passing of time. Either way, in a 21st century museum gallery in London, the red dust seems to emphasize the distance from an ancient West African forest kingdom. Prince Akenzwa is a professor of pediatrics as well as royalty. He is tall, very dark-skinned, a man of aristocratic bearing. Back home in Benin City, when visitors come to his house, they fall on their knees in front of him, and even in London he carries some of that authority. He has been coming to England for many years. He has children and grandchildren here, whom he visits regularly. But, as he told Julie Hudson, he had always avoided the British Museum. Now, in his new role as the Oba's special envoy, he felt he had to overcome his reticence. When he eventually spoke, still sitting on that bench, he talked of his people's pain and trauma and loss, and Julie listened in silence. Later, Julie took Prince Akenzwa into the stores, the vaults where the British Museum keeps the majority of its collection, unseen by the ordinary visitor. It was her idea, and he agreed. The British Museum has about 950 Benin bronzes that were taken in 1897, but including the plaques, it only displays around 100. Julie and Prince Akenzwa were joined on this journey into the museum's hidden bowels by Prince Akenzwa's son-in-law, a man called Enotie Ugbebo. Enotie is in his early 50s, but looks younger. He is an artist, confident and charming, and shares his father-in-law's good looks. He, too, is part of the team from Benin working on a plan for the return of the Benin bronzes. In the British Museum's stores, Enotie felt overwhelmed. "So many things in these foreign places," he said later. He was upset, angry, but also, he had to admit, relieved to see how well looked after Benin's treasures were, everything neatly stacked and catalogued. Julie recalls that Prince Akenzwa and Enotie were complimentary about the care the British Museum takes, even over objects that the public rarely sees. They dwelled over specific ones, they discussed them, and Julie learnt new information about pieces she had studied for much of her professional life. Their engagement was striking. They took a lot of time. They were moved, she said. A few months later, another Benin artist, Victor Eich Kamenor, stood in front of those same plaques in the British Museum. He had come to London to open an exhibition of his work in a West End gallery. Victor's art is difficult to define. He paints, he works with fabrics, he takes photographs, he produces large pieces of installation art. For his London exhibition, he displayed a series of patterns on paper made from thousands of tiny perforations, and mythical and historic figures made from rosary beads sewn onto lace textile. Many pieces explicitly referenced the 1897 British invasion of Benin. Victor was in demand, riding a wave of international interest in contemporary African art and well known to leading London dealers. Earlier in 2017, at the Venice Biennale, he caused a stir with a verbal attack on the British artist Damien Hirst, whom he felt had tried to pass off a new sculpture as original, although it bore a close resemblance to an historic piece from Nigeria. Hirst said he had acknowledged that his inspiration came from Nigeria, but Victor accused him of exploitation and saw uncomfortable echoes of previous thefts of Nigerian treasures, above all the Benin Bronzes. The dispute was picked up by British and American newspapers and widely commented on back in Nigeria. Victor is not a person afraid to speak his mind. In the November darkness, Victor walked from his Bloomsbury hotel across Russell Square and into the British Museum. He stared at the plaques. When I asked him how he had felt at that moment, he paused for a long time. It had not been easy for him to go to the museum. I was proud, I was very proud to have seen the mastery of the work of my forefathers. They were the finest, they were classical, even if their identity is not properly documented. But his culture felt diminished and out of context. What did the visitors who ambled by know or care of Benin and its Oba? He didn't like the way the plaques were displayed on poles. In an article he wrote for the New York Times, he said they were suspended like washed old underwear left to dry in the wind. To the left of the plaques, the British Museum displays more Benin pieces in glass cases. Among these is perhaps the most famous of all Benin's artwork, an ivory mask believed to depict Queen India, the mother of the 16th century Oba Esigi. It's a small thing, only some 23 centimeters long, but I can't look at it without feeling moved. The Queen's eyes are dark, inset with iron pupils and lids of bronze, making a lovely contrast with the aged ivory. She has a haunting feminine beauty. Her hair, in a humorous touch, is crowned by a tiara of 10 miniature bearded Portuguese heads, inlaid with copper wire. The symbolism suggests an alliance between Benin and Portugal, and maybe what Benin perceived as its supremacy in that relationship. I feel she exudes sadness, but perhaps this feeling comes from my knowledge of the mask's story as much as its aesthetics. For this mask was also plundered by the British in 1897, one of five similar ones often said to have been taken from a chest in the Oba's bedchamber. In the 1970s, Nigeria asked to borrow the Queen Idia mask to display at a major international festival celebrating African arts and culture. The British Museum refused, saying its conservation could not be guaranteed. This still causes hurt and anger in Nigeria today. When Victor looked at Queen Idia, he felt he was visiting a relative behind bars, and you know your relative is innocent. He spoke of her as if she was a living thing. He wanted to tell her, "I'm proud of you for holding up." But afterwards, he felt heartbroken, angry, all those emotions. The British Museum is often characterized, not entirely without reason, as a closed and defensive institution. But after that first visit, Prince Akenzua and Enotia were given a standing invitation from Julie Hudson to return and see any part of its Benin collection, and they both did so. They felt they were always treated respectfully. They also believed an ongoing dialogue between the Kingdom of Benin and a group of Europe's leading museums with Benin bronze collections was bearing fruit. I think their mindset is changing, Enotier told me. These included museums from Austria, Germany, the Netherlands, and Sweden, but the British Museum was the most important. This was in part because it had more, and arguably more important, pieces from Benin and received more visitors than the others. But also, after all, it was the British who took the treasures back in 1897. The British Museum is at pains to stress its autonomy from the British government, but it's not a distinction the rest of the world has always taken on board. The European museums in the Benin Kingdom, joined for its part by the Nigerian government, have been meeting since 2007 in what they call the Benin Dialogue Group. Benin City, the capital of the kingdom, is in Edo State, one of 36 states which comprise the Nigerian Federation. The people who live there are also known as Edo, and although the hereditary Oba is still venerated as a spiritual leader, it is the elected state governor who controls the budget and has more political power. In 2017, Prince Akenzwa, speaking on behalf of the Oba and with the support of the governor of Edo State, Godwin Obaseki, made an offer to the Benin Dialogue Group. They would build a royal museum in Benin City. From there, an outline of a compromise emerged. The European museums would give this new museum some 300 Benin bronzes. Crucially, these would be on loan for a few years each, rather than permanently returned. The idea was that if all the European museums cooperated, the practical effect would be, in Prince Akenzwa's words, a permanent display in rotation of Benin City's long-lost treasures. I would be very, very happy that the people, the young generation, could see the achievements of their ancestors, he told me. But it was a difficult compromise for some to accept. Victor A. Kamanor was blunt. The lending back of stolen objects was an insult. We shouldn't have to ask over and over to get back what is ours. This is the story of the Benin Bronzes, of who made them and why, what they say about African history, and of how Europeans interacted with them and Benin's Obas for many centuries. It's also the story of how they were taken in 1897, what happened to them next, and whether they should now be returned. It's a dramatic and tragic tale, but it's much more than that. It's a story about the way the meaning and value of objects changes over time, and of how the Western world, and especially its museums, is struggling to respond to changing assessments of the past. For Benin City and the Edo people, indeed for Nigerians and people of African descent as a whole, this is a story about the quest for restitution after an historical injustice. This cry, barely heard in Britain and Europe for many decades, has grown louder and more insistent. In the summer of 2020, as people in cities and towns across Britain protested against racial injustice and statues of slavers came down, it seemed more urgent than ever. On a personal level, as a British person enriched by years lived in Nigeria, I wrote this book with an urge to understand and cast light on one of the ugliest episodes in British colonialism. Some argue that the return of the Benin Bronzes would not just be a source of pride in the past, as Prince Akenzwa had told me, but would help inspire a new generation of Nigerians. If there was an opportunity to get these objects back, says Enotier, so that people could see what their illustrious forebears were able to achieve, and to understand that we're a proud civilization that has been sustained for over 1,000 years, then I think people will sit up and strive for what is better in the present day. But hidden in that very hope is a tacit admission that much has gone wrong in Nigeria in recent decades. For this is also a story about past failures and disappointments, and whether Nigeria is doomed to repeat them. The success or otherwise of current efforts to return at least some of the Benin bronzes will have a significance way beyond the world of museums or even Britain and Nigeria. They could be a harbinger of a more equitable relationship at last between Africa and the countries which colonized it, and, on both sides, a more honest understanding of the past. 1. The closer one gets to Benin, the farther away it is. They wave their arms in the direction of the palace, wailing and shouting. There are some 50 of them, men and women standing in separate groups, dressed in traditional robes. They have travelled to the palace from surrounding villages as supplicants, hoping the Ober will hear their case. They could have gone to the law courts, but they prefer to come here, for they revere the Ober. Perhaps they want him to mediate in a family feud or a dispute between neighbours over a piece of land or an issue of traditional protocol, whether such and such a person may conduct a ceremony even if they are not a chief. But for now, they must wait. They are held back by a fence. On the other side, guards look on indifferently, rifles hanging at their feet. Palace chiefs, distinguished by their white robes and orange-red coral necklaces, lounge in the shade by the entrance of the two-story neoclassical building. They can hear the cries. They look up each time these reach a crescendo of distress, but they make no effort to be helpful. As a distinguished historian of Benin, Philippe Igbafe put it, "There is much that is old in the new Benin. The old chieftaincy titles are still used, the old ceremonies and customs still practiced. People pray in church in the morning, but they take care to worship at ancestral shrines in the evening. The palace compound sits at the very centre of the city, just as it always has done, six roads converging on the adjacent King's Square from the different points of the compass. The metal gates to the palace are silver-coloured, decorated with motifs of elephant heads, eagles, and the faces of elegant queens. Palace wards, or perhaps just young men who pretend to be, hover by these gates. They whisper of special access and a guaranteed appointment with an important person within, as others might do outside a Nigerian airport or a government ministry or a telecoms office. They explain with sincere faces that there is a pain-free shortcut on offer, but it will cost a small fee. When the Oba is ready, he will listen sympathetically to the stories of his subjects, pronounce judgment, and they will accept his verdict. Agda Noba Oyefu Ogema. The fear of the king is the wisdom of our culture. So I am told by Patrick Oronse, a genial man in his 60s, whom I meet one Sunday morning in Benin City. He is an artist, an historian, and a philanthropist. He is also royalty. Like Prince Gregory Akenzwa, he is a great-grandson of Ovonramwen, the Oba overthrown by the British in 1897. When Patrick speaks of Benin's history, he gets animated. Names and dates and anecdotes tumble out in quick succession, a dense tangle of local and Western cultural references. It's hard to keep track, all the more so because of the interruptions from Vivaldi's Four Seasons, the ringtone on his ever-buzzing mobile phone. His history is littered with phrases of communal law illustrating the Oba's tight hold over Benin society. Ohai Gwogyonba. There is no hiding place for the Oba's enemy. Ta go ba, ta wang bo, ta ewe mi, ta we su. You worship the Oba, you placate a deity, you venerate the ancestors, and you appease the devil. And instead of saying that an Oba has died, a Benin man prefers to talk in metaphors. E ben via, the leopard is sleeping. Or, o sorwe buin, the white chalk has broken. Or simply, Owen Dokon, the sun has set. Benin City's traffic-clogged and potholed streets, its hazy polluted air, its sprawl and red-rust metal roofs don't always evoke past glories. I first visited 20 years ago to see its famed earth wall, which dates to the 13th century and rings the city with a circumference of some 11 kilometers. Archaeologists have measured a height of more than 17 meters from its top to the bottom of the adjacent moat. It is compelling evidence of how Benin's rulers could mobilize manpower. One archaeologist estimated that if the wall had been built in a single dry season, it would have required 5,000 men to work for 10 hours each day. It is listed as a Nigerian national monument. Unfortunately, this offers no protection, as I discovered on that first trip. Rogue constructors dug away at the earthworks with impunity, looking for house-building material in the red, clayey subsoil of the banks and rubbish accumulated in the moat. 20 years later, it was in an even more pitiful state. At a junction on the Sokponbar Road, beneath a heaving market, the wall was obscured by 5 billboards celebrating evangelical churches. The pastors and their wives, in garish outfits, looked down from the posters with compassionate expressions. I ducked under the billboards, away from the shouts of the traders, the music, car horns and revving engines, and climbed gingerly up the earth bank, holding onto bushes for balance. The ground was coated with the slime of human excrement and plastic bags. When I reached the top, I saw that the moat on the far side was full of sewage. Everything stank. This degrading sight jarred with the picture Patrick Oronce was painting for me, of Benin as a society of intricate hierarchies and elaborate rituals of old customs and beliefs rigidly adhered to. And yet Patrick also conceded that some traditions were under strain. We were meeting in the orphanage his mother had founded in 1951, and which he'd taken over upon her death. In the early days, Patrick explained, the typical child brought to the orphanage had a single mother who had died in childbirth. But after the economic downturn of the 1980s and 1990s, something changed. Parents started to abandon their own children. For the first time, the center does not hold. The extended family concept has died. Every man for himself. People find children on the street and bring them to us, said Patrick, pointing to a solemn little girl in a blue dress who had emerged from the gloomy building behind us. She was perhaps 3 years old and held tightly to Patrick's leg. Try telling her I'm not her father, he said. She had been left with him when she was 5 days old. People are throwing away their children. Patrick is a born raconteur. He could talk and talk about the great obas of the 15th and 16th centuries, the breadth and reach of the Benin Empire at its zenith, the art and culture of the court at its center, its achievements and its cruelties, the forests and animals which surrounded it. But any conversation about Benin and history inevitably leads back to one fateful year, to a certain Vice Consul Phillips brushing aside the warnings and marching into the forest, and to everything that followed. 1897. Before and after. A world turned upside down, says Patrick. There is, he adds, another saying about Benin's history. Eboriato rea conquewe ewiaha. The British man has spoilt the earth and he has spoilt the skies. He has ruined everything. If you walk from the Oba's palace, it might take you 5 minutes to reach Igun Street. Much depends on the traffic around Benin City's central roundabout, whether it fleetingly relents and you have the courage to plunge through the cars, buses and motorbikes and ignore their urgent horns. At the turning for Sokponbo Road, you'll pass a statue erected in the 1980s. A Benin warrior, cast in dark metal and carrying a spear and shield, stands triumphant, a silhouette against the harsh, bright sky. At his feet are strewn 4 British soldiers. 3 are slumped and clutch their stomachs in agony. The 4th has collapsed and appears to be dead. The statue captures a moment of heroism from 1897, even if the invaders' uniforms and weapons appear more Second World War than late Victorian. Asoro, the Oba's trusted warrior, is said to have fought valiantly at this point, slaying the enemy until finally he too fell. From a crushing defeat, the statue seems to say, an eventual victory emerged. Benin did not die. Asoro's battle cry, Sokponba, only the Oba dare pass this spot, has been immortalized with the naming of the Sokponba Road. Igun Street, the next turning on the left, was there long before the British marched in. You enter through a red arch inscribed with the words Guild of Benin Bronze Casters, World Heritage Site. The street runs ramrod straight, lined by modest single-story clay houses. The casters and craftsmen display their wares on the front terraces, rows and rows of twice-life-size brass leopards, American bald eagles, Greek and Roman gods and mermaids, monstrously long brass tusks, shiny icons of Benin history glued onto wooden or red felt backgrounds, wooden giraffes and paintings of scantily dressed women. Christian, classical and Benin traditions are carelessly merged together. It's easy to be unkind about what Igun Street has become, and many are. Young artists in Benin or Lagos, and the more discerning expatriates in Lagos, dismiss most of its offerings as kitsch, tourist, or airport art. One longtime American observer of Benin City likened the street to Tijuana. Even Igun Street's claim to global recognition is dubious. When I checked the website of UNESCO, the body which awards World Heritage status, I was deflated to find no mention of it there. The miracle of Igun Street is not what is sold at the front of its humble stores, but what happens in the workshops and studios behind. On patches of broken land, surrounded by cast-offs and piles of breeze blocks, men sit on plastic chairs and wooden benches and work on their bronze and brass casting. They are the roughly 120 members of an exclusive guild, Igun Ironwan. They use skills learnt from their fathers, who in turn learnt from their fathers, and so on, all the way back, they say, to the 13th century. A few of the families that make up Igun Eronmon have moved to other parts of the city, but most remain on Igun Street, working as they've done for the past 800 years. Until very recently, this was an exclusively male craft. One prominent caster said that if a woman learnt the skills and then married, there was a danger she would take her knowledge to her new family. They call their technique lost wax. It was practiced by the ancient Greeks and Romans and across Europe during the Middle Ages and into the Renaissance, often referred to by its French term cire perdue. But there is nothing inherently European about lost wax. It was used in ancient Egypt, from Mesopotamia to the Indus Valley, in Southeast Asia, and in ancient China. It was used by the people of Central America before the arrival of Christopher Columbus. And in sub-Saharan Africa, lost wax was used on Igun Street in Benin City before the first white man appeared. It is a complex process that requires skill but allows for intricacy and detail. Imagine a member of Igun Eronwan wished to make a ceremonial head of an oba. He would begin by shaping a solid core of sandy clay with his hands, maybe using a wooden or metal file to refine it. Today, as in the past, the casters get their clay from the banks of the Ikpoba River, which runs through the north of Benin City. Once he has shaped the core into a rough form, he covers it in a thin layer of beeswax. Now he introduces detail, not just in sculpting facial features, but also perhaps by adding extra wax thread to make the beads of a headdress or the coral bead coat an oba might wear. The wax must be soft enough to allow such detail, but hard enough to keep its shape. Next, the caster covers his wax model in finely grained clay. He is trying to ensure this outer covering takes a faithful impression of the wax beneath it. Then he adds a layer of heavier clay to the outside, while ensuring there is a small furrow through which the wax can escape. He dries the piece in the sun and then bakes it in charcoal embers until it reaches such a heat that he can pour away the melted wax. Now the critical moment. The caster takes molten metal, bronze or brass, from a furnace and pours it into the mold left behind by the departed wax, filling every hollow and tiny crevice. If he has failed to heat the piece sufficiently, it may crack when he pours in the liquid metal, and he must throw everything away. Often the caster must wait for a tense half hour as the piece cools. He may seek the blessing of Ogun, the patron divinity of craftsmen, spilling spirit on a shrine. Then he begins to prise away the clay exterior in the hope of finding a perfect metal cast underneath. Some things have changed. Traditionally, the members of Igun Eronwan used bellows and human sweat as they toiled to heat their furnaces, whereas nowadays many use compressed air from air conditioner motors. The supply of metal ebbs and flows. In the late 1960s, as the Biafran War raged to the east, Benin City's casters reveled in a windfall of spent bullet cartridges. Today, old engine parts are a staple source of raw material. Enterprising women deliver bags of discarded taps, valves, and pipes. Dealers bring ship propellers on their trucks, salvaged from the rusty hulks of the Niger Delta. For hundreds of years, the Igun Eronwan Guild worked for its one and only patron, the Oba. He provided security, slaves, money, and other gifts, but little freedom. Now, members of the guild can sell their work to passing tourists, or hope that a hotel or bank will commission a monumental statue for a foyer, or that a wealthy man is looking for a metal design for his mansion gates. Or perhaps an evangelical pastor would like a giant pair of praying hands to decorate the exterior of his church. Other things are much as they were. The successful caster has always been more than an artist. He must also be a master of pottery and metallurgy. The lost wax method is still laborious and unforgiving of shoddy shortcuts, poor material, and bad craftsmanship. The caster can make only one piece from each wax mold. There are no replicas, no way to run off a few extra copies. Each piece, masterpiece or mediocre, is unique. These days, many people in Benin City and beyond complain that there is too much of the latter, not enough of the former. They criticize casters for being stuck in the past, unimaginatively churning out lackluster imitations of their ancestors' work. A Lagos art dealer, his home a temple of refined taste in traditional and contemporary Nigerian sculpture, told me how saddened he was that members of the Igun Eronwan Guild spend all their efforts to replicate rather than using those skills to represent what is happening in their own time. But this is hardly surprising. Benin City's casters, like so many in Nigeria, are struggling to get by. They need food on their table before they can think of experimentation and creativity. The Omadamwen family are pillars of the Igun Eronwan Guild. Phil Omadamwen, the head of his foundry, says his family have been casting for 500 years. An impressive but self-effacing man in his late 40s, Phil has good connections with wealthy expatriates in Lagos and international art dealers. Many of his biggest pieces are commissioned from overseas. "We have standards, the Omadamwen family," he says. "We're very careful with the materials we have." Phil has traveled to the United States, Belgium, and France to exhibit his work. He has two children in private universities, with the help of God. He employs 50 people and has a gas-fired foundry to handle larger orders. And yet he says the future is precarious. Phil used to sell his work for good prices to foreign workers in Nigeria's oil capital, Port Harcourt, but kidnappings and insecurity in the Niger Delta have made journeys to that city increasingly dangerous. His own children are not interested in becoming casters, and he is not surprised that young people want to make their fortunes in other ways. "I have cousins who left. They went across the Sahara Desert. They tried to cross the rough sea. Not all of them made it. Some are in Europe right now, maybe seeking asylum. The work here is very capital intensive. If you don't have good customers, you won't be encouraged to do more." The members of Igun Eronwan have no formal training. They are not taught to sketch. They are not draftsmen. They learn by watching and listening to their fathers and elders and studying photographs of the celebrated pieces of Benin art. But just as they are criticized for rigidly adhering to traditional designs, they are also criticized for failing to attain the high standards of the past. Where, some have asked, is the sensuous subtlety of their predecessors? But this begs the question of where inspiration should come from. Today's casters can see only a small proportion of the old art and rely on magazine and internet photographs to study their ancestors' greatest works. The canon of Benin's art, the encyclopedia of its civilization, was stolen and is scattered across the globe. According to one tradition in Benin's oral history, bronze and brass casting began in the time of Oba Ogwola, who ruled from about 1280. Ogwala wanted his people to master a new craft and asked the king or oni of Ife, some 200 kilometers to the northwest, to send him a brass caster. This man, still venerated by the Igun Eronwon Guild, was called Igwege. Ogwala instructed the casters to live at the current location of Igun Street, where they have remained ever since. Other oral traditions trace the origins of metal casting hundreds of years earlier. If mythology suggests this culture was thriving long before the first Europeans came to Benin in the late 15th century, so does more tangible evidence. In 1938, in the town of Ibo-Ukwu, 170 kilometers to the east of Benin, a farmer called Isaiah Anozie was digging near his house when he discovered a series of sophisticated ceremonial bronze pieces, which archaeologists dated to the 9th century. In the 1970s, archaeological digs in Benin City showed that metal casting was taking place in the 13th century. Bronze and brass are copper alloys. Bronze is made primarily of copper and tin, while brass is primarily copper and zinc. Both alloys are easier to cast than pure copper, as they melt at a lower temperature. They are also harder and more resistant to corrosion. To a person seeking to make a weapon or an object of beauty, bronze and brass offer a significant improvement on copper. People living around the lower stretches of the River Niger would probably have had access to copper and tin deposits, both of which are found within a few hundred kilometers. They were therefore in a position to make bronze. The origins of brass in this part of Africa are more mysterious, as there is no evidence of zinc production. And yet the magnificent brass heads of Ife, excavated in the early 20th century and often compared to the finest sculpture of ancient Greece and Rome, are believed to date from between the 13th and early 15th centuries, again before the first Europeans. This suggests that brass came to the region overland from the north on a trans-Saharan trade route, perhaps originating in the Mediterranean, the Middle East, or as far away as India. The Oba, in the words of historian Philip Igbafe, was the pivot around which everything revolved, the supreme religious as well as the civil authority. The Igun Eronwon Guild worked to command from the palace. Bronzes were produced and distributed only on the orders of the Oba, and any other persons wishing to obtain a casting would have to apply through him, wrote the British anthropologist Raymond Bradbury, who studied Edo society in the 1950s. Some Edo historians say that a guild member risked execution by making a bronze or brass casting for anyone except the Oba. Pieces might be lent out to an important official, but would be returned on their death. Little wonder, then, that so much of Benin's historic art is dedicated to exalting the Oba, to affirming his power and mystique. Most famously, each Oba is commemorated with a brass head, one of Benin's defining artistic legacies, and a tradition said to date from the 15th century. The crown prince was obliged to commission a head of the just-deceased Oba to be placed on an altar inside the palace as the focus of ceremonies in honor of royal wisdom and authority. On brass staffs, the Oba stands atop an elephant. On ancestral altarpieces, he holds an ebén, the fish-shaped ceremonial sword with which he dances to honor his ancestors. The Oba is prominent on many of the hundreds of rectangular brass plaques which decorated his palace. He is often the largest figure in the middle of the plaque, cast in the highest relief, wearing the most elaborate headdress and robes, flanked by a pair of courtiers who support his arms, which are weighed down with regalia. Sometimes he is seated on a throne. He might be sacrificing a cow or even a pair of leopards, a demonstration of his mystical powers. Or a plaque might record a specific moment of royal triumph, such as the Oba Esigi's famous victory over the neighboring Igala in 1515. Benin's art features a glorious repertoire of other characters and animals. There are statues of horsemen and hunters, musicians and messengers, courtiers and dwarves. The leopard, the mudfish, and the elephant, all emblems of the Oba, are depicted on stools, staffs, hip masks, and vessels, as are rams, snakes, crocodiles, and birds. Many of these pieces decorated the shrines and altars of the Obas of the past. The human figures represent his retinue, the recurring animal figures' various spiritual properties. The art reflects the Edo people's animist beliefs that it wasn't only humans who possessed souls and spirits, but also animals and plants, even the earth and sky around them. The people of Benin have a poetic saying, Agasse do, Edo yiri. The closer one gets to Benin, the farther away it is. The interpretation of its past is always in flux. The great 20th century historian of Benin, Chief Jacob Egerevba, writes, many, many years ago, the Benis, as the Edo were often called, came all the way from Egypt to found a more secure shelter in this part of the world. There are other mythologies passed down in oral history. The youngest child of the high god Osanobwa was sent to live in the world with his elder brothers. He sailed in a snail shell across the world looking for dry land, until a bird told him to pour sand from his shell, which created land, and he thus founded Benin. Another more prosaic myth is that there were people living in the present location of Benin, and they needed a leader. They chose a prominent man, Igodo, who became the first Ogiso, or ruler of the sky. Igodo is said to have built a palace in what is now the heart of Benin City, and to have tried to bring some centralized control over the scattered communities in surrounding forests. The Ogisos, Benin's first royal dynasty, are believed to have ruled from approximately 900 to 1170. In this time, there were the initial stirrings of artistic expression, with the creation of guilds for wood and ivory carvers and weavers. There were 31 Ogisos, but their authority fell apart under the last one, Owodo, whom Egerevba says was responsible for a long period of misrule, failure, and anxiety. The Obas, the second dynasty of Benin kings, which would rule uninterrupted until 1897, rose in the power vacuum that followed the fall of the Ogisos. According to one theory, it was the Kingdom of Ife which bestowed the new dynasty on Benin. The chiefs of Benin, tired of the anarchy of the late Ogiso period, sent a deputation to the king of Ife, the Oni, asking him for a ruler. He sent his eldest son, Oranmian, who spent only a brief time in Benin, but impregnated the beautiful daughter of a nobleman. The child, Eweka, would be the first Oba, and would enjoy a long and glorious reign. An alternative theory reverses the primacy of Benin and Ife. This time it was the son of the last Ogiso, a prince called Ekaladerhan, who fled from Benin to Ife to escape his would-be executioners. Blessed with magical powers, he became king there. The chiefs of Benin sent a delegation asking him to return, but he said he was too old to travel and could not abandon his new kingdom. He offered his son in his place, but only if the chiefs could master a curious challenge— to domesticate 7 lice for a period of 3 years. This they did, having cultivated the lice on a slave's head. Suitably impressed, Ekaladerhan sent his son, Oranmian, to rule Benin. Oranmian's son was Eweka, the first Oba. In this way, the new dynasty was not an alien imposition, but a continuation of the old. To an outsider, the credence given to one ancient myth over another might seem an unlikely cause of contemporary controversy. But in the fraught world of Nigerian politics, where ethnic groups thrown together during British colonialism compete for access to resources, the claim that one civilization may be older, more sophisticated, and therefore more legitimate than another is highly contentious. In the first years of the 21st century, a very public row erupted between rival traditional kings and intellectuals on the origins of Benin and Ife, which rumbles on to this day. There is nothing obvious about Benin's location that helps explain its rise. It is on a rolling plain surrounded by thick forests. Inland from the sea, on neither lake nor river, it is not especially well placed to prosper from trade and communications. Its people have no tradition of exploiting by canoe the network of Niger Delta rivers to the south, let alone seafaring in the open waters of the Atlantic beyond. Predominantly farmers, they trade yams for fish with the neighboring peoples who live closer to the coast and are more comfortable on the water, the Urhobo, Ijaw, and Itsekiri. And yet, by the 16th century, when the name Benin started to appear on European maps of Africa, the kingdom was in a golden age, not just of military power and territorial expansion, but also cultural wealth and artistic expression. The period from the establishment of the Obas dynasty at the beginning of the 13th century to the arrival of the Portuguese at the end of the 15th century was one of consolidation of royal authority. It was Aweka's son, Oba Awedo, who compelled his chiefs to stand, not sit, in rows before him, a custom that served to emphasize his power and which would endure for centuries to come. In the late 20th century, an archaeologist in Benin, using radiocarbon dating, estimated that a mass grave of at least 41 young women was from the 13th century. The bodies lay at the bottom of a shaft 12.5 meters deep, an apparent ritual sacrifice, a suggestion that Benin was a place of fear and power. Awedo is credited with giving his kingdom the name of Ubini, from which Benin is thought to be a later European derivation. Awedo's son, Oba Ogwolo, began building trenches around Benin City. Archaeologists' estimates of the full extent of these earthworks have undergone a dramatic escalation in recent decades. They have mapped outer walls, some 145 kilometers of earthworks, which ring the inner city walls. But these pale into insignificance if we accept the conclusions of an eccentric and untiring British scholar, Dr. Patrick Darling, who spent many months in the late 1960s and early 1970s hacking at the jungle and interviewing villagers in the countryside around Benin. Darling traced a dense network of earthworks which surrounded settlements in cellular patterns, known as ia. He estimated their total length was 4 to 5 times that of the Great Wall of China and involved the removal of 100 times the amount of material contained in the Great Pyramid. The rainforests around Benin, wrote Darling, had brooded silently over the remains of the longest and most massive earth constructions yet known from the pre-mechanical era. Darling's theory was disputed by some, but given an imprimatur of recognition with an entry in the Guinness Book of Records. Darling attributed much of this construction to the Ogiso period, but it is Oba Eware, whom Egarevba says ascended to the throne in about 1440, who is traditionally credited with building those mighty, but now sadly neglected, inner walls and moats. These, presumably, were defensive, but Eware the Great is remembered as a warrior king, powerful, courageous, and sagacious. How far did his power stretch? Egarevba's claim that Eware travelled over every part of modern-day Nigeria, Dahomey, Ghana, Guinea, and the Congo seems fanciful. But more plausibly, his armies are credited with starting an impressive series of conquests closer to home. These would eventually extend to the west along the coast to Lagos and perhaps as far as Ouidah, to the northwest to the Yoruba towns of Ekiti, Okore, and Owo, to the northeast into the Ishan area, and to the east to the banks of the mighty River Niger. This means Benin's influence may have spread over an area from east to west of some 600 kilometers, and in places some 150 kilometers to the north. The frontiers ebbed and flowed, but at home Oba Eware was constructing something more permanent, a divine kingship to dominate politics and religion. He established the principle of primogeniture to stabilize the line of succession. Eware tightened his control by organizing chiefs into associations and societies, and introduced new ceremonies, including the annual sacrifice of a leopard, to enhance the mystique and spiritual authority of royalty. To this day, the people of Benin say, Egbe wai agyobase. Eware is the yardstick by which all other obas of Benin are measured. Eware not only fortified Benin, he also deliberately burnt it to the ground in order to rebuild it on a grander scale. It began to be referred to as a city, and it had a new name. Eware is said to have chosen Edo in honor of a slave who had saved him from execution after the treacherous plotting of a chief. The word is used not just as an ethnic term, but also to refer to the city and the language that is spoken there, Although Benin and Benin City are the commonly used terms internationally and are widely used in Nigeria as well. Eware built broad roads radiating outwards from the palace at the center of the city to his newly acquired territories, emphasizing its significance as the political and spiritual heart of the kingdom. Eware is credited with beginning the tradition of the casting of commemorative heads of deceased obas. But there is another character who starts to be represented on the Benin bronzes soon after his reign, and thereafter appears with intriguing regularity. He might be shown as a small man floating in pairs behind the oba on a plaque, identified by his pointy nose, beard, and long straight hair. With a feathered cap, he can make for a comical, flighty figure, especially in comparison with the oba in the foreground staring out from his throne. On other plaques, he is alone, with a crossbow, hunting birds, or drinking from a flask or smoking a pipe. Most impressively, he is depicted in a series of statues between 30 to 43 centimeters high, wearing 16th or 17th century armor, firing a musket or crossbow. He is the European. 2. Easily as big as the town of Haarlem and enclosed by a remarkable wall. The first recorded encounter between Benin and Europe was in 1486, when João Afonso de Aveiro, an emissary of the Portuguese king, arrived in Benin City and paid his respects to Oba Ozolua with gifts of guns and coconuts. It was the beginning of a peaceful relationship between Obas and visiting European delegations, which would last for more than 400 years. There would be differences between them, but pragmatism invariably prevailed. Each had things the other wanted to buy. Dealings were usually cordial, in fact, often friendly. By the mid-1480s, Portugal's brave and skillful seamen were on the verge of rounding the Cape and sailing on to India. They had been trading along the Bight of Benin for some years, penetrating the rivers of the Niger Delta, and had surely heard stories of the kingdom a short journey into the interior. João Afonso wanted pepper, as West African spices, the Malagueta, Afromomum Malagueta, and Ashanti or Benin pepper, Piper Guinnessy, were much in demand in Europe, bringing pungent aromas and strong flavors to dull cuisine. But above all, he was looking for slaves. This was not yet for a transatlantic trade, but as part of a barter process along the West African coast. The Portuguese exchanged slaves they bought in the Bight of Benin for gold with the Fante people on the Costa da Mina, what the English called the Gold Coast. Indeed, the Niger Delta rivers to the south of Benin were already known as the slave rivers. Oba Ozolua, in the tradition of Eware, was a warrior king, known as the Conqueror. According to Egarevba, he was respected at home and dreaded abroad. When he marched with drums and fifes against his enemies, the inhabitants of the towns and villages deserted their homes and fled into the bush at the sounds of his coming. In fact, Benin became a terror to all other tribes in this part of West Africa, and the Benin Empire became wonderfully enlarged. But the Portuguese encountered no hostility. The Oba agreed they should take back an ambassador from his people, and so a chief from the river port of Ugoton sailed to Lisbon to learn the language and customs of the fascinating newcomers. He was judged a man of good speech and natural wisdom by the chronicler at the court of King João II, and returned to Benin laden with gifts for his family and the Oba. João's successor, King Manuel I, hosted two more ambassadors from Benin, known as Dom Jorge and Dom Antonio, to whom he gave velvet capes and shoes and camlet waistcoats. For both Africans and Europeans, these encounters were of political and economic, even religious, significance. The Edo associated the Portuguese with Olokun, the white-faced god who sent wealth and children from below the sea. The Portuguese, for their part, were on a quest to find the mythical Christian king Prester John, who, according to a contemporary writer, lived somewhere in Africa and whose dominions reach very far on every side, and hath under him many other kings, both Christian and heathen, that pay him tribute. By building a relationship for the first time with an African kingdom of the interior, Portugal's search for Prester John became that bit more hopeful. The Portuguese, slavers though they may have been, were also out to save souls and sent missionaries to convert the Oba and his people. Pacheco Pereira, who visited Benin four times in the 1490s, complained, "The manner of life of these people is full of abuses, fetishes, and idolatry. An Oba whose authority over his people depended on his own godlike status might not have welcomed Christian teachings, but there was a tempting quid pro quo." King Manuel, in a letter to the Oba in 1514, dangled the offer of a powerful new technology. "For when we see that you have embraced the teachings of Christianity like a good and faithful Christian, there will be nothing in our realms with which we shall not be glad to favor you, whether it be arms or cannon and all other weapons of war for use against your enemies." Thus a spiritual flirtation began. Portuguese priests arrived in Benin in 1515, the first of many European missions over the coming centuries. In Benin's oral history, they met the new Oba, Esigi, who allowed his son and several other young men to be baptized and taught to read and write. At least three churches are said to have been built at this time. Nothing remains of them, but historians in Benin City point out their locations to interested visitors. Egarevba wrote that the Portuguese succeeded in baptizing thousands. In the meantime, it seems the Portuguese had kept their side of the bargain. In 1515, Oba Esigi was fighting a war of survival against a local rival. The Ata of Ida, ruler of the Igala people, was a formidable enemy to the north, who, perhaps with the assistance of cavalry, forced Benin's army back to its city walls. Disaster was narrowly averted, according to common law, because the Portuguese stepped in with their guns. It was, Patrick Oronce told me, an intervention that changed the course of Benin's history. Two white men, Ava and Uti, are said to have fired the weapons with stunning effect. Noise, smoke, death at a great distance. The Ida army reeled back. It was a major victory. The Ata and his men were driven back across the River Niger, and Benin's hegemony expanded to the confluence of the Niger and Benue rivers. The arrival of the Portuguese was also of profound cultural importance to Benin. It was a catalyst for artistic production. The Portuguese brought cargoes of manilas, heavy bracelets shaped like a horseshoe made of copper, bronze, or brass, as a currency of trade. A single ship could carry some 30,000. The manilas were melted down by Benin's metal casters, raw material for thousands of Benin bronze pieces which survive to this day. The sheer quantity of this influx gave impetus to an artistic tradition that was already established and quickly made any trans-Saharan brass trade all but irrelevant. The Portuguese had strange features. They wore unusual dress and they carried powerful weapons. All of these inspired Benin's artists. Other goods they brought with them, cowries and especially red coral beads, were incorporated into Benin's traditions and regalia. Benin's ivory carvers, who belonged to a separate older guild, the Ibasanwan, also responded to contact with the Portuguese and produced pieces of astonishing beauty, enriched by fascinating cross-cultural fertilization. An intricate salt cellar depicts at its base four Portuguese men in dress from the 1520s to 1540s, while a fifth rides in a boat above their heads, holding a telescope. The form is European, the style uniquely Edo. The ivory sculptures also include the celebrated five pendant masks of Queen Idia, one of which so moved the artist Victor Eikamanor on his visit to the British Museum. She is also gloriously commemorated in metal, a rare female representation in Benin art, for the Oba's wives, said to number between 600 and 4,000, and tended by eunuchs and young girls, lived a life of seclusion in the palace. The Portuguese legacy lives on. They came to be known in the Edo language as Ikbotoki. The coconuts they introduced to Benin, coqueiro in Portuguese, are known as ecocodia in Edo. The Portuguese for ball, bola, is ibolu in Edo. And warehouse, armazém in Portuguese, is armazemi. But trade with Benin came at a high price. João Afonso de Aveiro earned his place in Edo mythology with that initial journey of 1486, but Benin ultimately cost him his life, just as it did for so many Europeans who followed. He fell ill with fever on a return journey and died in Ugoton. According to Egarevba, he was buried in Benin City, and his death provoked great lamentations. Pacheco Pereira, in the 1490s, complained that all these rivers are very unhealthy because of the fever, which does grievous harm to us white men. The most common cause of death was malaria, and it would be another 350 years before Europeans developed effective ideas on how to avoid it. Already, the West African coast was acquiring its deserved reputation as the white man's grave. Benin in the 16th century was at the height of its power, the royal court a place of pomp and ritual, and there were limits to Portugal's influence. The Portuguese offered fine cloths, but Benin already had these in abundance. In 1538, King João III sent a second group of missionaries. These three men wrote a letter home, detailing their frustrations. They had been allowed to present a cross and statue of the Virgin Mary to the Oba, but he had since refused to see them, and they were prevented from returning to the palace. The Oba partook, they complained, in superstitions, abominations, and errors. Most grievous of these was human sacrifice, the first European reference to a practice in Benin City which would eventually assume a fateful significance. After a year of frustration and sickness in Benin, the missionaries were refused permission by the Oba to return to Portugal, and their final fate is unknown. Nor does it seem Benin entered the slave trade with any great enthusiasm. There is an Edo saying, Wo da ba, no na mu vien hein. What does the Oba lack that he would need to sell his slaves? Benin was victorious in war and presumably had many captives. The Portuguese paid for slaves with manillas. In the first years of the 16th century, Pacheco Pereira wrote that a slave from Benin cost between 12 and 15 manillas. By 1517, the price had risen to 57 manillas, and Portugal's need for the bracelets rose accordingly. In 1548, a German merchant house agreed to supply Portugal with 432 tons of brass manillas for the West African market. The Oba's apparent reluctance to sell male slaves in the early years of European contact is indicative of their wealth and confidence. Perhaps, historians suggest, he and his chiefs had more use for them at home. Patrick Aronce draws a careful distinction on attitudes in Benin towards slaves. Slave trading was not part of our culture. Slavery was part of our tradition. The story of England and Benin begins on 12 August 1553, when a little fleet set out from Portsmouth, hoping to return from West Africa laden with pepper. The three ships, the Lion, the Primrose, and the Moon, were well furnished with men of the lustiest sort to the number of 70, according to a contemporary writer. These included a teenage Martin Frobisher, later a famous explorer of the Northwest Passage and hero of the defeat of the Spanish Armada. The expedition had two leaders, a naval officer from Norfolk called Thomas Wyndham, and a Portuguese knight, Antonio Agnes Pinteado, who was fleeing enemies at home and presumably invited to bring Iberian expertise on a journey never before attempted by English ships. He was described as a wise, discreet, and sober man, much respected for his knowledge of sailing. The fleet reached the Gold Coast, location of present-day Ghana, but Wyndham wanted to push on to Benin, where he was convinced he could buy a profitable crop of pepper. Pinteado, who may have feared the consequences of being captured on an English ship by his fellow countrymen, warned that it was too late in the season to carry on, and that the sailors would succumb to a smothering heat of such putrefying quality that it rotted the coats off their backs. Wyndham was having none of it. He cursed Pinteado as a whoreson loo, Jew, and threatened to cut off his ears and nail them to the mast. Pinteado, intimidated and against his better judgment, led the fleet eastwards. What did those intrepid sailors in their wooden ships see as they approached the coastline near Benin? As one historian put it, a vague grey line penciled in between an immensity of sea and sky, a dangerous surf-pounded beach and the occasional river leading into a maze of mangrove swamps and creeks. And beyond that, impenetrable forests and fever. The mouth of the Benin River is some 3 kilometres wide, but an underwater sandbar makes it too shallow for larger ships to proceed upstream. Wyndham stayed with the Lion and the Primrose in open waters, while Pinteado took the smaller Moon over the bar and into the mangroves and brackish creeks. He reached Ugoton and set off on the 40-kilometre northeasterly trek through forest to Benin City, where he was brought into the presence of the king, who sat in a great hall, long and wide, thronged with people. This king, Oba Orhogboa, was treated with respect, even fear, by his people. When his noblemen are in his presence, they never look him in the face, but sit cowering, with their elbows upon their knees and their hands before their faces, not looking up until the king command them. Likewise, when they depart from him, they turn not their backs toward him, but go creeping backward with like reverence. Oba Orhogboa and his visitors were able to communicate, for he was the son of Oba Esegi, who had been baptized by the Portuguese as a child and taught to speak, read, and write their language. The meetings could hardly have been warmer. Orhogboa showed great gentleness to the delegation and offered them credit if their merchandise was not equal to the value of the pepper he was happy to sell them. It could have been the beginning of a long and fruitful relationship, but at this point things went very wrong. While Pinteado waited for the Oba's men to collect pepper from the surrounding countryside, sickness, perhaps yellow fever, swept through the ships back at the river mouth. Some 4 to 5 of Wyndham's men were dying every day. He wrote to Pinteado demanding his return. Then, in a panicked rage, Wyndham smashed up Pinteado's cabin, destroyed his instruments, and plundered his food and water supplies. By the time Pinteado made it back, Wyndham was dead and the surviving sailors in a state of volatile fear. They sunk the Lion as they no longer had enough men to sail her. Pinteado argued they should wait for their companions who were still in Benin, but the sailors attacked him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.